There we go.
Hey, there we go. Hello. Welcome to the Cubist. My name is Bill Corey. I am the Cubist and I'm back. I spent the last week in Utah on a boat in the middle of the desert, which is a weird sentence to say out loud, but here I am. So tonight we are going to deep dive Puerto Rico and it's going to be just the two of us. Mr. Patrick Hillier this week, apparently with his clothes firmly on his body. Thank you for joining me tonight.
Sir, for having me back. I wasn't sure I'd make it back on the show after last week.
Well, in the interest of full disclosure, I have not watched last week's show yet. I have not had time. So I have no idea what happened. And I think I've sort of decided that ignorance is bliss and I'm okay not knowing because I've heard stories. I've had people talk to me on Twitter going, even you, Patrick, were like, don't watch last week's show. Don't. And I'm like, oh God, why? So I haven't watched it. I'm just going to choose that everything is great. I know that we got a ton of Twitter followers after the show last week, so something must have gone right. I don't know.
Highest rated episode ever.
It's right up there. I don't know. So whatever. Y'all are weird. This is what happens when I pass along things for 1 week is I get naked Patrick.
Half naked.
Half naked. You know, we don't know that. Do we know that? Did you stand up?
No, I did not know.
You could have been all the way naked, Patrick. You have threatened to not have pants on at the show before, so.
Well, that's a normal occurrence, but anyway.
No, that's fair. That's fair. All right. So let's do this, Patrick. Let's start where we always start with stuff that we've played lately. I took games on the boat.
Cool.
Yeah. Well, you know, everybody in this group. Okay. So I don't want to talk too much about my trip because it's not really relevant, but there were 10 of us on the boat and Molly and I are the only gamers of the 10, right? And it was basically 8 other people that played party games and traditional card games. And that was about it. So they said, hey, you have games. You should bring games for us to play. All right. So I went out and bought Telestrations, the 12 player pack. And I brought that on the boat. For those of you that don't know, Telestrations is basically the published version of Eat Poop You Cat, which is a public domain party game where one person writes a word and then the next person draws a picture of that word and then that person writes what word they think that picture is and back and forth. So it's sort of like telephone, but with telephone meets Pictionary, for lack of a better word. And so I brought the 12 player pack and then I gave it to the guy that had planned the whole trip and said, you know, hey, thank you very much because that whole group likes playing this anyway. And I thought with the flipboards, they'd really like it. And I have decided that I like Telestration so much better than the public domain version because I like the cards. I could care less about quote unquote point scoring. I think that's dumb.
Yes.
It worries me a little bit that there are people that really felt like what we really desperately needed was a point scoring system for a game like this. It actually reminds me of Concept a little bit where there's supposedly points, but I don't know anybody that actually gives a crap about the points in Concept. And it's the same thing here. I think you're just playing for the experience, which is awesome. So I like the Telestrations version way better. Plus it's just smart, right? With the dry erase boards. I don't know how this is a thing that hasn't been, you know, decided on or whatever, but I really liked it. So like I said, I gifted it. So I no longer own it. I owned it just for the purposes of this trip and then gave it as a gift to the guy that planned it, but I thought it was good. I think it's boy, I don't know. This is hard for me to rate, right? Because I think this is a play it because I don't think you need to spend the money.
I think you do. I really like the wipe off boards. They have instructions on them. Keep shay.
That's true. That's true. The instructions, that way nobody can get confused and you can't drop the stack of paper. Because that's happened before. Have you ever played this with just piece of paper, Patrick?
Maybe once.
Okay. When you play it with pieces of paper, invariably somebody stops paying attention and accidentally fumbles the whole stack of slips of paper. And then it's just chaos, right? Then you basically have ruined one person's game. So I guess from that, if you like the idea, yeah, I guess it's a buy it. I don't know. You really have to have the right boy, this one's tough for me because I think that it's good. I just don't think that everybody's going to dig it. And I think there are going to be a fairly large segment of people that just aren't going to enjoy this style of game.
I've never met anyone who didn't like it.
Really? All right. But see, you are that kind of guy that you surround yourself with that with the right people for this kind of game, right?
That's true. That is probably true.
And I think as far as like stereotypical gamer type, I don't know. I don't like stereotyping people. I don't know. I'm going to go with the play it just because I think that it's going to be, you could duplicate the thing for free with pieces of paper and pens. And I don't think you need to buy it, but it's good. It's good. I like it. So hello chat room, by the way, I typed it quickly, but hello, glad to see the live chat. We'll be interacting with y'all a lot more over the span of the show, just because there's only two of us. So Patrick, what have you played lately?
I was going to talk about Wasteland Express Delivery Service by the Fleeples and Mr. Gilmore.
I'm super excited about this one.
Yeah. I was pretty, I pre-ordered it. So let me go way back in. I was interviewing Jonathan Gilmore with Brandon for our What Did You Play This Week conversation episode. And Brandon was talking to him. So I had freedom to type on the computer and actually pre-ordered it while we were interviewing Jonathan, because I was so excited about a pickup and delivery, you know, game. Yep. And we've probably talked about Merchant of Venus before, so I kind of hoped it would be something similar, but different enough, which it is. Anyway, so it comes with a 4x4 modular grid of regions with sort of these stops at the intersections of the corners, and you're just driving your truck around, and you're picking up one of three goods and delivering them to the other places. There's a supply and demand mechanism in the game that changes throughout the game, kind of like, oh, was that game Ecuador? What's it called? Eva? Anyway,
I know you lost me there.
Navigador has a kind of a moving, oh, gotcha. You know, has this moving grid up in the corner where the value of goods goes up and down, and I just think that's interesting too. And then there's these sort of bad guy trucks that are driving around that you can interact with. You end up in the same square with them, and they kind of are moved by the other players, so they can move them on top of you or not. And that causes a little bit of player action. There's not a lot of player interaction. It's mainly just a racing pick up and deliver game. So set in a post-apocalyptic world. It's got some pretty fantastic art. It's a little PG-13. As far as art goes, but other than that, and then it has just the most amazing game trays set up, kind of like we were talking about before the show, Mech Warrior. What was it? No,
Mechs versus Minions.
Mechs versus Minions. You know, it just all comes like pre-set up almost in a box for you.
The custom vacuform thing.
Yeah. Yes, that are designed for that game.
Yeah, I dig that. Small World, I think, is the first game that really did that, right, with the mm-hmm. little trays, so that we're. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I really dig that. This game just screams overproduced to me in all the right ways, right? Like,
yes.
I haven't played this yet, so I have no idea really if the gameplay backs up the production values, but from what everything I've seen about it, it's just everything about this game is just ramped up to 11. From the little, you actually put the goods in the back of the little bandit trucks that sit out yes. there, right? And they're made mm-hmm. so that way they physically fit inside the trucks as bananas.
Yeah.
But then there's standees.
Yeah, I know.
And here's the deal. I don't mind standees actually in games. Like I have the standees version of Gloomhaven and it's fine. I don't really care if I have miniatures for, you know, the adventures or whatever. I think standees are fine. But when you also have custom molded little trucks that you included in there and then you do standees, it just seems weird to me. I don't know. I like it. I really geeked for this. This is a huge box too, right?
Oh, yeah. I'm looking over. Yeah, it's about colonist size.
Holy crap.
If not a little bigger, but it's 7 pounds, I think it said. I mean, it's unlike colonists. It's bottom to top full when you open it up with the trays.
Wait, what do you mean unlike colonists?
Well, I didn't think the colonist was completely stacked.
Pretty
cool. I mean, there's a lot of stuff in there. I'm not complaining about that. I'm just saying Well, my colonist is in I can't really say because mine's in Plano boxes. So I don't
know. Yeah, I was gonna say nobody that owns the colonist has it anything like how it comes in the box anyway.
Right.
Like you can't just because it would basically be unplayable. All right. So Wasteland Express Delivery Service, Jonathan Gilmore, Ben Pinchback. Wow, that's not even a hard word to say. I just screwed that up in Matt Riddle. What do you think? Buy it, play it, forget it, or burn it?
I mean, I've only really just messed around with it. I can't even tell you that much. It's been on my mind so much lately that I want to play it more. Matt Roy keeps his colonists loose in the box. Thank you. It's going to be a play it.
Yeah. I think my only concern about this game, and I really want to try this one. It bears mentioning, by the way, for those of you listening afterwards in the audio version, or maybe later on down the road, if you decide that you like our show well enough to go into the back catalog, maybe it's episode 100 where you are and we're way back here. Well, this is the show immediately following Gen Con 2017.
Correct.
So there's a lot of first impressions that are probably going to happen over the next couple weeks as we talk about stuff that we maybe played at Gen Con. So just kind of keep that in the back of your head too. Mm-hmm. I'm a little worried about the price point versus the depth of play here, right? Like for me, when I spend a bunch of money on a game, I want a commensurate amount of gameplay experience out of it. Does that make sense? Yeah. This seems like a very pricey game for... I don't know.
I'm not sure. It comes across as being a longer game, which gets, you know, you some value out of it.
Right.
And there is some sort of campaign mode in it, too, that's in the back of the book. Okay. That adds some value to that, too. But that's again, cool. I've not explored it enough to talk intelligently about all that.
BGG's complexity rating is 2.8 out of 5. So kind of in the middle. They're calling it basically a medium.
Yeah, it's not super complicated.
Okay. It's gorgeous. And I love pick up and deliver anyway, right? Like this is one of my the genres of games that I only recently realized how much I enjoyed. And so, as a matter of fact, that reminds me, I should talk about that. Ha! I just thought of a game I can talk about. But yeah, I really want to try this one. I need to try this. It's so pretty, and John Gilmore is such a great guy anyway that I'm a little bit of a fanboy just because he's such a rad dude.
Well, and Matt and Ben too. We actually hung out at Gen Con. They're nice guys.
I have heard nothing but the best about the two of them. I don't know either one of them personally, but so there you go. All right. Speaking of pick up and deliver, I just realized that 2 weeks ago, the last time I had a game day besides being on a boat in the middle of the desert, I taught my friend Ben Empire Builder.
Oh, cool.
And I hadn't. Yeah, and I have a copy. I have one of the older. I have the oldest of the new edition.
Mexico?
No, it has Mexico.
Okay.
That's so not it's, old. Then. Right, but it's not the newest printing with the prettied up artwork, right?
Yeah,
like okay. It's the first printing with Mexico, that makes sense. Okay. So for those of you that may not know, Empire Builder was originally published in 1982. So this is truly old school board gaming. This is the progenitor of the crayon rails games. You got yours sitting over there?
I'm looking to see. I think mine is from 82.
Oh, wow. You have the old
one. I think that's why I asked, because I think that's what version I have.
Gotcha. That's the one I originally had, too. Mm-hmm. And then I ended up getting the newer version when I was still working with Mayfair at the time. So, short version, in Empire Builder is the quintessential pick up and deliver. Do you think this counts as the original? I think maybe. In modern board gaming, this is the...
Yeah, I'm not sure when Merchant came out. It was about the same time, 87, I think, as Merchant. So
Empire Builder beat it.
Yeah, probably.
There you go. This is quintessential pick up and deliver. You have to create train routes from cities that make goods to cities that want the goods via these demand cards that'll pop up. And the way that you create the routes is by literally drawing on the board with your crayon, hence the name Crayon Rails. I am a firm believer that Empire Builder is not the strongest game in the Crayon Rails series. I believe that title goes to Euro Rails, but I don't own Euro Rails. And honestly, Empire Builder is fine for me, right? Like I recognize that Euro Rails is a better game, but I don't think it's such a strong enough distinction that if you own one, you need to buy the other one and replace it, right?
Yeah.
You see what I mean? So, and I own lunar rails. That's a weird second one, but I have lunar rails also, which is the one on the moon.
Yes.
That one is nigh on impossible to play, though.
It is hard. It is hard.
Because the biggest reason is just because nobody knows the geography of the moon, right? So, like, mm-hmm. you can't find anything mm-hmm. on lunar rails, where at least in Empire Builder is Canada, the United States, and Mexico. So, if you are American or Canadian or Mexican or whatever, you have at least a reasonable chance of understanding the basic geography of where things are. And also, Eurorails is pretty good in this respect as well, although a little bit tougher for us USA centric folk.
That's what I heard.
Yeah. Also, because in Eurorails they write the name of each city not in American but in the whatever it would be in their language, right? So, like, Vienna is Wien, W-I-E-N.
Oh, right.
Which will throw people off, right? So sometimes, you know, if you're teaching people that aren't particularly Eurocentric or Europhiles or whatever, they make it a little lost. So I love Empire Builder so much. I really do. It's such a good game. It's relaxing, and you find yourself thinking long term, and it just ticks all the right boxes for my spreadsheet of a brain, right? Like, I love that you have to look at your load cards and figure out what it is that's going to be, that's going to work well for what you've gotten dealt. I just really like it. To me, yeah, it's a buy it. I think that you owe it to yourself to own one Crayon Rails game. Now, having said that, if you buy Eurorails instead, you'll be just as happy. Maybe even slightly happier. Like I said, I think it's a slightly better game, but it's not such a big difference. It's so good.
Yeah.
So good. Get it.
I agree 100%. I do have a couple anecdotes to tie onto that. So were you done?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. So I was sitting at an event at Gen Con with Sean. I think it's Sean from Bullfight. No. What is Sean's last? Anyway, Sean. And we were chatting. And I said, are you from Canada? And he goes, yeah, I'm from Calgary. And I'm like, well, I know where that is because of Empire Builder.
Empire Builder, yep.
Actually, I have a T-shirt that says everything I knew about geography I learned from Empire Builder, which is true, especially about some Canadian geography, because I know. And then I'll whip off like, oh, yeah, that's just like cattle in Calgary, if I remember correctly. So
yes. You guys are famous for your cattle.
Yes. Then, don't know why.
Like, shut up.
And then, you know, as long as we're talking about Crayon Rails, the other thing that excited me at Gen Con was the release of Iron Dragon reprint.
Yes.
So Kathleen Mercury, our friend, mm-hmm. is a huge Iron Dragon fan. And go ahead.
Tom Wham is a local hero to this.
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
I'm friends with Tom. So I'm really excited that this is easily Tom's most commercially successful game.
Yeah.
I think that's easy to say out loud. So I'm really excited that this is getting reprinted.
Oh, by the way, go ahead.
He posted a picture of him posing in front of the van with the Iron Dragon logo. And I was so happy for him. I'm like, good for you, Tom. I'm glad he got to see that.
Yeah. Darwin Bromley, who mm-hmm. worked on the original one, mm-hmm. was on my CoozyCon, and I played First Class with him, which was kind of fun. But didn't know who he was at the time until I got back. But anyway, the whole point was there was a big Mayfair area. Let me sidetrack a little bit. So Lucas Oil was completely open now as a play area for Mayfair games mainly.
Oh, Mayfair basically got the whole stadium.
Well, about a third of it was tables and chairs that were Mayfair. Wow. One third of it was the library. And another third was a recreation of the original horticulture hall and a Gen Con museum that had sort of artifacts, which was just a bunch of stuff that you and I grew up with in glass cases. And then a lot of pictures and drawings and letters about early Gen Con and then Gen Con through the ages. But anyway, I actually had gone back to look at the museum, and then on my way back, I saw some people playing Iron Dragon. So I stopped and I took some pictures of it.
Very cool.
And as a new board, new fat crayons, really fancy art on the cards, which looks great. And my only disappointment, and you know, this was in a 5 minute look at it, was that, and I don't know if they do it nowadays, but the coins are cardboard. Oh, and every version of every, you know, I've got probably 10 different versions. They're all plastic, tiddlywink sort of things.
Sure.
And I'm, you know, I didn't pick them up because the other people were playing them, but that was just my only commentary was a observed negative. Yeah.
Missed opportunity. I could see that. I could see that.
But, you know, when you're talking about not being able to find things, that was one of the things they sort of fixed in Iron Dragon. When me and my buddy played that a few months back, they sort of like named all the cities sort of A and put all the A's in this quadrant and then all the B's in this quadrant. And you kind of picked up on that after like 10, 15 minutes of playing. We're like, and knew the map before we knew it.
Yeah. Yeah. That was really smart of them. I actually remember talking with Tom about that because I, one of the things I grumped about when I first played it was that I couldn't find anything. And he's like, well, it's all letters.
Yeah.
Like, wait, what? And then I look, oh my God, it is. I'm an idiot. All right, cool.
Right.
Then
versus the Mars one or the lunar one where they give you like a stupid little grid thing that says, okay, you know, at P7 is, you know,
southeast, whatever. And you're like, that's not useful, a little bit. Like, it feels like it would be. High Frontier actually has a similar problem, right? Like, when you play High Frontier 3rd Edition, you're trying to find all the different named asteroids or whatever. And they're like, oh, well, it's southwest of Seoul. Thanks. What? Which way are you? You know, and then you have to be rotated, right? I actually drew a coordinate system on my board, which is ridiculous. But. I'm super excited for Iron Dragon. I need to, you know what? I will amend what I said before. If you haven't bought a Crayon Rails game yet, buy that one. Wow. Start with that. I'd say that because it does add some interesting other stuff, right?
It adds the boats and tunnels
It adds some pretty groovy stuff that adds just enough to it. Plus, you get a fancy new version, which is awesome. And you support Tom. Tom's awesome.
Yeah.
There you go. Very good. All right, Mr. Patrick Hillier.
Okay.
You put two copies of today's deep dive on your shelf behind you as visual props. I appreciate that very much in case you really want to get a good close look at the bottom half of the box. Tonight, we are deep diving Puerto Rico. This is the classic Andreas Seyfarth game from 2002. We were talking about this before the show. It feels like it's older than that. It's hard to believe it's only 2002. This game came out. This is the role selection economic game, for lack of a better term, I think. And it won a ton of awards. It's ranked number 12 all time on BGG. They call it weight of 3.29 on the complexity rating. I would argue that that's a little bit high. For what it is, I don't think it's actually that complex of a game. I think it's just got
probably an old rating from.
Yeah. We were talking about that too. We'll get to that at the end of the show. Don't let me forget, Patrick. We got to come back to that topic in a minute. But so let's dig into this sucker. First off, let's get our baseline, like we always do in these deep dives, and where our opinions lie on the game. I'm gonna guess that the guy with two copies on his shelf really likes this one.
That is correct, sir. One of my few rated 10 games.
Wow. Okay. See, and I think that I used to really like this game when it first came out and then sort of fell out of love with it.
That happens.
And I think the reason I fell out of love with it is because it started to feel a little solvable. This one has what I call the blackjack conundrum.
Yes.
Which is the proper play thing that experienced players will get flustered with if non-experienced players don't do.
Yes, and that's why I have two copies.
Wait, what?
We can get into that in a later or now.
I want to know right now why. This is why you have two copies.
Right, because, okay, so I have the original game, and you play with people who are very more experienced than I am, and they have that. They have the corn theory about I'm going to do this, or if you're sitting to the left of them and you don't play, you know, you don't play the production before the buy. I forget the words, the terms, you know, the mayor action. You got to do them in the right order and all that. And so I wanted to get the, I missed out on the anniversary edition, which is nice. But that includes the building expansions. Mm-hmm. And there were two sets of building expansions that came out that they included in the big anniversary box. And what those do is you mix up the standard tiles. So not everyone is going to go out and buy the Hacienda first or a small office first, like everyone does in the standard openers, because mm-hmm. you've added in 3 or 4 or 8 or 12 new buildings instead of the standard ones and kind of shake the game up. So I really wanted to get those building. So I ended up buying a whole new set from somebody in a trade that came with the buildings in it, with the building expansions in it, so that I could play it with older, more experienced folks as well as brand new folks and kind of breathe new life into what I think is still a great game.
Gotcha. I played with the first set of expansion buildings when they were a print and play. Like, I made them myself, if I recall correctly, and attached them. Yeah, I'm thinking back about it. There was a, speaking of Tom Wham, Tom is the one that introduced me to the idea of self-adhesive floor tile as a way to make quick and dirty tiles for things, for like prototyping. One of the first prototypes that I ever made was literally self-adhesive floor tile with just printed paper stuck to the adhesive side of it, and then you can cut it with a pair of scissors. And so I made my own Puerto Rico expansion with that self-adhesive floor tile long before it was ever for sale. It was just on the website and you print it and away you go. And I remember playing with the expansion and thinking, all right, this helps, but it still felt like all it did was expand that tree of proper play, right? Like, there was still this blackjack conundrum. It was just a wider net. Now, okay, this building is in, so therefore this is ramped up. And yeah, if this building and this building are in, then this is ramped up. And it felt like almost, it felt similar to how Dominion feels. So when you play Dominion, the whole puzzle of Dominion is looking at the 10 kingdom cards that are out there and then figuring out this is the combo that is going to work the best, right? Like, mm-hmm. the game is won and lost by whoever can analyze the setup before the game even starts. That's how the expansion started to feel for me, which then took the shine back off of it, which made me sad, right? Because I wanted to feel the way you did. Now, I have not played with the second expansion at all. Like, the second set of buildings, I have no
experience. Yeah, right. That's Nobles, I think.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know anything about that one. But
anyway. Yeah, okay. No, it's not perfect. I'm not.
Yeah, yeah.
It for sure. Probably does not warrant the 10 I give it. But every time I play it, I walk away just am so happy that I did play it, because
I feel that way about a lot of classic games, right? Like, even if the game isn't perfect, the fact that I'm revisiting an old friend, it feels yes. like visiting an old friend.
Right. That's kind of the, yeah.
The game that I always point to for that is Kalis. Even though I think that there are other worker placement games that are maybe better than Kalis, I always feel the same way, because it's like, oh, see, I remember this, you know, and then it just kind of brings me back to that time when I first learned it. So I think that's maybe part of where that comes in. So let's talk about the solvable stuff, because in all the other deep dives, we have avoided expansions. We have basically said we're talking about the base game only, and then we mention them occasionally, but we're like, we're not judging the game based on the expansion-y stuff. So in the interest of consistency and in the interest of most people will have played it with the base only, right? Like, is that's fair?
I agree with that, yeah.
Okay. So let's kind of just stay, we'll focus on the main one, and let's talk about this, what I call the blackjack conundrum first, which, by the way, the reason that I call it that, for those of you that maybe don't go to casinos ever, is when you're sitting at a blackjack table, if you hit when you're not supposed to, or you don't hit when you're supposed to, according to whatever proper play is, everyone at the table gets mad at you, right? And then they will yell at you, and then it is your fault if they lose. Yes. Of course, it's also not your fault if they happen to win. Then they got lucky despite you, but then you're a jerk if you did the wrong thing. And I feel like that's the trap that's what caused me to fall out of love with it. I think it's just too many people that felt that way. Has that been a problem in your games?
I can't say it's been a problem. It's been a problem where it's really stupid, but like people wanting to sit in certain like locations. Like, I don't want to sit next to Jimmy, you know?
Oh, because Jimmy doesn't know how to use the Craftsman?
Right. Or something stupid like that. Or, or he's going to screw me because he's going to do this first, you know?
Sure. I know that there are people that claim that there are certain positions, player positions that are stronger or weaker.
Yeah.
Like apparently third is terrible or fourth is terrible or something like that in a four player game. Like there are some, I think it's second sucks, right? And third.
Oh, I don't know.
I don't remember. I used to know this really well. So
mm-hmm. Yeah, no, there's definitely opinions on it though.
Yeah. Boy, you know, as soon as you start thinking that hard about a single game, I
don't know. Oh, people math the hell out of this. And a lot of those older games too, though.
I guess. All right. Yeah. I had, so the blackjack conundrum was such a problem in my groups when I used to play this game that the website, the Aaliyah website used to have a building maker. Okay. It had a widget that you could type in whatever you want and it would create a purple building. So you could basically make your own expansion buildings. And I made one called the Private Retreat. Okay. It cost zero. It cost one or something like that. It was one victory point. And the rule was that if you owned it and had it manned and a player gave you unwanted player advice, they had to give you either a coin, a good, or a victory point. And I literally put that into the game because people would be such jerks in my group about how, well, you have to do this. What the hell are you doing? You can't do that. Mm-hmm. This is ridiculous. And it just got ugly. And that's probably a big part of what caused me to fall out of love with the game.
Right.
Which is sad, right? Ugh, I hate that. I don't know. I feel like I have an unfair opinion of the game. Eric in the chat room approves of my mechanic, the unwanted advice mechanic.
But, yes. Is that one? Yeah.
To be fair, Eric.
Oh, go ahead.
I was going to say, to be fair, Eric, I would lose every game I played. Like, I'm such a hypocrite, right? Because I would lose every game I played if that was a mechanic in all games. Go ahead.
I was just, one of the things I like about this game, though, is sort of that mean interaction that happens, that, oh, I'm going to take the shipping action because the captain action, because I'm going to be able to ship something, but none of you are going to be able to because the boats are full or the boats are going to be able to, or the office action, the same sort of thing. And there's really a lot of strategy in looking at what other people are doing. It is not a solitaire game.
No, it's, right? it's passive aggression.
Yes.
The board
game. It's all me.
Yeah, because it's I'm not, you know, I'm not saying that this is definitely going to screw you over. This is just really good for me right now.
Whatever happens after my turn.
Yeah, it's not my problem. You know, I'm sorry that you didn't set yourself up in such a way to make good use of what is clearly the best play.
You should have taken the producer last turn. Sorry.
See, and we're doing it now. We're not even playing the game, and we're literally doing the same thing. We're saying, oh, my, well, if you hadn't been so stupid and not done the thing you would have done, then definitely you'd have been right there. I just don't say that.
That's the whole difference.
For sure. You know, and I think that I'm going to tell an anecdote really fast here. About 2 or 3 years ago, my friend Chris was at his game night up in Sheboygan, which is about 100 miles from where I live. And I drive up there once in a while and game with them. And he called me and he's like, hey, Bill, we're about to play Puerto Rico. He said, I know that you have a strategy that you typically use that works really well. Can you tell me? And I said, sure. And I walked him through exactly what I do. And I said, okay. And I said, you'll win by about 40 points and it'll be upsetting to everybody else at the table. Let me know. He's like, okay. And he called me back about 2 hours later. He's like, yeah, I doubled the second place player's score. That was ridiculous. And I said, that's sad that I could hand you over a 2-minute phone call, a strategy that you know would work. And I can even tell.
Was it the corn strategy?
No, it's whatever.
That's the one I know by name.
No, the one that I use, and I guess it can be headed off if people know what you're doing, is you get a cash crop, either tobacco or coffee. You use that to get enough money to buy yourself a factory. Then you diversify and get a harbor. Rinse mm-hmm. and repeat. The factory means you'll never run out of money. The harbor means you'll always be able to you'll always get extra points, even for only shipping one good at a time, and you're off to the races.
That's fair.
And I've never, I mean, I'm not going to say I've never lost with that strategy, but I've never been out of it. Like, I've always been in the hunt every time I played. And the fact that I could literally say that to him in that fast of a time period and have him go, holy crap, and then win by a lot, worries me. So then that brings up the next thing, right? Yeah, don't play Puerto Rico with Bill.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. No, that's the whole
thing. That's incorrect. I want people, and this is the thing, right? I want to be wrong about this game. Because what I was going to say is this game solvable? Is this truly a solvable game?
I don't think so. I haven't played it that much.
Yeah. And I probably have 80 plays of this. Yeah. Because when Brett Spielbelt was the only game in town online, mm-hmm. Puerto Rico was one of the only games you could play on there. And I played it obsessively. And of course, at the time, there were, you know, because that was the only online board gaming site, there were always people on there. And I was so obsessed with this game that I would sit and play two or three games a night, you know, and do that over and over and over. So I probably have, I'm guessing at 80 plays. It might be more. I have no idea. I walked into Brett Spielbelt. Is that even still there? Does that exist?
I don't know. No, I don't. I was just looking to see who has it, if anybody has it.
I played it. It's an app.
Android. It's an iOS app.
Okay. Gotcha. So here's,
or Dan, we're making him never want to play it.
Well, Dan, here's what I'm going to tell you. I think that everybody should play this game. I think you should just not play it so much that you obsess about it. And I think this game is a victim of its time period.
Mm-hmm.
Because in 2002, when this game came out, there were not a lot of Euro games that were being made. We didn't have such a wide range to choose from, right? You didn't have, you know, 50 hot games coming out every year that you could pick and choose and say, this is the game that really speaks to me and this one not so much. We didn't have that. We didn't even, think about it. This is pre-Facebook. This is pre-social media in general. So we didn't even have like crowdsourcing opinions. Basically, you were having these conversations at conventions and that was about it, right? I mean, podcasts maybe existed, but not really, or at least not in any wide format. So there wasn't, we didn't have the variety that we have now. And Trevin, I see your question. I will get back to you. Hold that thought for like 2 minutes. I don't want you to don't lose that, because I want to talk about that in a minute. But I think that the variety that didn't exist in 2002 caused us all to obsess about this game too much. And I think we all went too deep and it made it too predictable. What do you think, Patrick? Did you play this a lot in 2002?
I don't know what I was playing in 2002, but I agree that that's what its problem is. So it's gone away, right? People don't play it like that anymore. So like Netters was on there earlier and says she doesn't play it that much and she doesn't have it memorized. So those are the people I want to play with, because I don't have it memorized. I know how to play it decently, but I'm not that good. So I just try to find people that haven't played it that much before, and we have fun with it. And it's still a good game for the next generation.
And to be fair, I don't think I have sat down and played a game of Puerto Rico aside from playing solo on my iPad. Mm-hmm. And even that's probably been a year or two. I mean, it's been a long time since I played it at all. And I definitely haven't played with other human beings in forever, which I actually sort of miss, right? Like, again, it's that old friend mentality, you know, that you play these old games. And it's like, I just get it. I just get this one. Yeah. Paul in the chat, you know, love it, but haven't played in years. Exactly. Because there's so many other games out there that coming back to an older game that arguably I think still has its flaws is, you know, it's hard to do, especially as media nerds, right? Because, you know, any of us that fancy ourselves as being media people, we're always trying to keep exposing ourselves to new stuff. So we have stuff to talk about, because that's how you abuse, yada, 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 that all kind of nonsense, which is of course where these deep dives come in. I don't know. I like Puerto Rico. I don't love it anymore.
Okay.
Like I did. So, all right. So let's talk about a couple other aspects of it. Patrick, pre-social media, when you first played Puerto Rico, did you even think about the brown colonists?
Nope.
Okay, me neither. Thank you for saying that. And I recognize that this is probably a perfect example of white privilege in action. All right, I am, yes. I am 100% aware of that. Part of the reason that I didn't think of it either is because I instantly replaced mine. This is the other half of it, right? So my copy of Puerto Rico that I owned back in the day, those brown colonist discs were out because I have huge sausages for fingers and I can't pick the damn things up anyway. So I replaced them with multicolored cubes. So, and then the cubes were colors based on player packs. So like in three players, you would only have this many colonists or whatever. And I just had, they would be all the red cubes or whatever. And then I'd add yellow for four players and blue for five or something like that. So, yeah, I didn't. So when I read that, I never even thought about it at first. And then I was like, oh, that's such a bad choice. Yes. Why would they do that?
Right.
15
but not years not. I mean, and then it goes beyond them being brown. You know, they're.
Yeah.
They're. Right. It's a really touchy subject that
I'm
not qualified to talk about.
Yeah, for sure. Neither am I. I just wanted to, make sure that I said something so that way we acknowledge the fact that the subject matter can be problematic for some. We don't want to gloss over it and say that it's not a problem. It's just not a thing, you know, that I basically was bringing it up to say is not a thing that I want to focus on too much because there are other people that are way more qualified to talk about it than we are. So
right.
We'll leave it at that. All right. Trevin brought up, and I said I wanted to come back to it, that I don't believe all games are solvable. And his implied pressure, like we said, that Patrick does not believe this game is solvable. I sort of do. But I think that's in the blackjack conundrum sort of capability. And I don't want to distract too far away from this. What is it about this game, Patrick, that you think makes it not solvable?
Well, I guess what I was getting at was the interjection of the new stuff. So, yeah, no, I'm not arguing with you that I think the original probably is solvable. That if everyone's playing kind of the same way, it's solvable, yes.
So then does it behoove you to play wrongly? Like, is it possible?
I don't know. Can you win by not playing, you know, contrary to popular belief, can you still win?
Sure. Or can you, yeah, can you win blackjack by hitting on 19? You know, your odds go way down, but it doesn't make it impossible. I don't know. And here's the thing. I get annoyed with other, I'm such a hypocrite, dude. And I freely admit that I am a massive hypocrite when it comes to some of this stuff. Okay. So save your hate mail. When I really like a game and then people come in and go, oh, that game is solvable and I don't think that it's really compelling because of blah. And I'm like, you know, shut up. Let me just enjoy the game. And now here I am doing the exact same thing to Puerto Rico, which this is why I say I'm a totally hypocrite here. I don't know. Maybe solvable is the wrong word. Predictable is a better word. That's maybe the better word for it, that it's not solvable. It's just, if everybody is at an equal skill level, then you can predict exactly who's going to do what on each turn, right?
Yes.
Like, you know that the small market's going to get bought first, and you know that, you know, the builder guy is going to get it for free, and then the next person's going to do this, and the third person's going to do that. And it really takes about two trips around the table before anything really odd starts to happen, right? There's this rhythm that every game sort of leads with.
Yes.
That you can't really get away from, especially depending on the player count. Like, I think four players is probably the most predictable out of the three, because it's 3 to 5. I think five is probably the least predictable, I would argue, and four is the most, and three sort of somewhere in the middle because you can do more things. I don't know. So yeah, predictable is probably a better word than solvable, which sort of goes away from what Trevin was asking in the chat, right? That you know, it's all games. Trevin says in the chat, and for the record, we try to read stuff out of the chat every once in a while because the audio version later on can't see this, of course. Trevin said that he recently heard someone claim all games are solvable with enough plays. Paul, scripted is a great answer. Yes, scripted is a good word for this as well. Yeah, for sure. I don't know that all games are solvable with enough plays because I think some games have enough variability in player choice that it's hard to solve it, right? Because the players can do so many varied and weird things, right? You see, what do you think, Patrick?
Yeah,
help me out
here. Yeah, I agree. Of what we call the classics, this is probably the one that I say has the most written about it, the most opinions of it being scripted, the most standard openers that I've ever read about. So I totally agree with you about.
Yeah. And I think that aside from Catan, I want to say that this is probably the first game that I can think of where people were really playing it super competitively and cared a lot about the competitive side of it. I mean, you know, we all have a certain level of competitiveness to our personalities, right? Otherwise, we wouldn't be playing competitive board games. You know, you're always playing to win. But I think Puerto Rico is one of the first games, again, besides Catan, where I feel like people really formulated strategies, you know, and almost chess-like, right? Where they were thinking about, okay, if this person's doing this, then I'm going to respond with this sort of a strategy, which will give me an increased chance of winning because I know that they're going to do this versus me doing this and whatever. Mm-hmm. I think that this was, so anytime you go that deep into any game, you're going to get a million different scripts. I really like scripts, Paul. That's good. I think that scripting is going to happen just because there's going to be so much, the over-the-top discussion. I have, every time we do one of these shows, okay, I have a BGG page open for whatever the games are that we talk about, just so that way I can flip through them. And there are 109 text reviews, 28 video reviews, and over 2,100 threads in the forums on BGG about Puerto Rico. That is banana pants compared to I'll pull up Empire Builder, which is 20 years older than it. Okay. It was around 20 years longer. And that has, let's see, 11 text reviews, 4 video reviews, and 192 threads. So 10 times as much content was created about Puerto Rico as about Empire Builder.
And that's why I like it.
Okay. Why? What do you mean?
Because it's just, clearly there's some depth to it, right?
Well, or at least there are a lot of people with opinions about it.
If you generate that much discussion, there's got to be some depth to it, I guess is my whole point.
All right.
I know it's been scripted. I know that, but I don't play with those people anymore.
That's fair. Netters, I want to play. I'm just saying. Netter says that she's not supposed to play with me. I want to play. Eric in the chat asks, do we have issue with point salad games with so much variety that you don't feel there are any incorrect choices? No, I love those kind of games because I feel like I can find my own path. One of the things that a negative descriptor for me of a game is if I feel it is too one pathy, right? Like if the game only has one way to go, and if you don't do this, you will lose. That generally, if I get that sense about a game, that game completely takes me out of my enjoyment. So I dig points out as a result of it. And I would argue that this is not one path, even though it's scripted. I think there are definitely multiple paths. I just don't think there are as many as people think.
Right. I think the scripting has more to do with the role selection than it does the building orders. I think there's lots of paths to victory in building orders and how you might make your way to victory. I'm never going to take production because somebody else is going to take that because I want to be able to do something with those goods that somebody else produces rather than giving them goods, you know, that's the more, I think that's the more scripted stuff, is like you were talking about the blackjack thing, the order in which the roles are selected. I feel there's lots of paths to victory in the game.
Sure. And let's face it, that's essentially the entire game, right? Like the micro decisions you make once you've chosen the role are definitely secondary to which role you choose when. I mean, that's basically the whole game. I guess not the whole game, but 75% of the depth of the game comes from when you choose which roles and why you choose them and the timing around and what the other players are doing. So yeah, I totally agree with you. So, all right. Some games with enough variation that they fundamentally can't be solved. Trevin's asking good questions. Trevin, welcome to the chat. I haven't seen you in the chat before. You're awesome. I like you. Other games with so many variations that they can't be solved. Everything by Stefan Feld. Like, pretty much everything Feld has ever made. Even the ones that I don't like, right? Like, I'm a pretty outspoken Trajan hater. You know, Mario Party, the board game. But even that, you know, that's the one thing I can't hate on it about, right? For sure. I don't know. There's a lot of them. There's a lot of them. That tends to be a realm of games that I tend to like better than others. So there's that. All right. So Puerto Rico. We're going to try and stay a little bit on topic. So yeah, we're doing pretty good, Patrick. We're staying fairly focused here.
Now. Yeah.
I mean, I haven't taken my shirt off yet, but other than that, please don't take it. See, did you notice, everybody, that Patrick is wearing an extra shirt in penance for last week?
Yes. And that it's really cold in my basement. You don't know how much I suffered last week for humor.
Well, I appreciate that you people are willing to put yourselves through physical discomfort to cover for me while I'm gone. That's
lovely. All right.
All right. So Puerto Rico, if we're going to rank this on the Cuba scale, buy it, play it, forget it, or burn it, where do you land, Patrick?
Oh, I'm a buy it, man. It's like $10 or something nowadays, isn't it?
Yeah, Lynn in the chat said that she found a copy for $1.50.
Yeah, if you get it for $1.50, you'll buy it. I mean, well,
for the record, if you get like anything is worth $1.50 at this point in our lives, right? Yes. Like pretty much any game, right, Trump the board game is worth $1.50.
Well, I stand corrected.
Nice.
All right, it's $20. For $20, this is a buy it. If you've not played this game, come on. It's number 12 on BGG. For $20, I think it's worth buying.
And it's available on, I think, all of the online.
I want to say it's on BGA for sure. I'm not sure.
Yeah, I think you're right on that one. Although, if only we had some way to look.
Yeah. No, I know I've played it on one of them. Me too, Eric. I have almost all of the killer bunnies.
I will take your $1.50. That game is not great, but it's also not nearly as bad as you think it is.
It's not, but still, it's something.
It's also not good.
Who's gonna take it? You know,
I will take your $1.50.
All right.
I'll take your $1.50. I will definitely. Yeah, Board Game Arena does have it.
Okay.
Actually, hang on. Yep, there it is right there. Yep, it's on Board Game Arena. There's an app version, a very good app version on the iOS store. I don't know about Android, but I know there's a good
version. There is no Android. There is an Android knockoff. I can look it up here in a minute. Go ahead.
Okay. But I mean, there's definitely ways to play it. And for the record, I think the iPad implementation on iOS is very good. I think that it's, at the very least, buying it on there isn't a terrible idea. Paul in the chat, the question is, do you need the expansions for replayability? That depends on how much replayability you want.
Super long term, yeah. Yes.
Right. Like if you are okay, so in the chat there were a couple of people that said figure out over plays together, no fun Googling the best way to play a game. And you know, if the group is learning things together, then I don't think you really need the expansions to get your money's worth out of it at this point in its lifespan. I really think that for, you know, the $20 or whatever that you're going to pay, or the $1.50 if you're Lynn, Christ, I would buy any game for $1.50. For that, you can get, you know, you're going to get 10, 15 plays out of it and you're not going to be sick of it yet, you know?
Yeah.
You really won't.
And they're rare. I mean, that's why I have two, because I had a really hard time tracking them down.
Oh, the expansions? Well, again, they're print and play. You can print and play those expansions.
Yes, you can.
So you don't have to spend more money on them. If you really want, if you buy it, you fall in love with it and you go, this is great. I really want more. You can get more for not that hard. It's really not that hard to do. Get yourself some self-adhesive floor tile, print out a couple pieces of paper, grab a pair of scissors and go to town and you can get your expansion. But do I think you need it? No, not in 2017. When there are so many, good games out there that I think you're, let's face it, how often are you going to grab a 15-year-old game? You know, and that's up to you. Maybe you only own 20 games and you're looking for something, you know, that's going to fill your tiny space underneath your TV, you know, with another game that you might want. I don't know. I don't think you need it. I don't think you need it. At least not nowadays. Expansions. Yeah, the expansions. You need the game. At the very least, the digital format. You should try it. You should for sure try it. So I guess in Cubist terms, I think it's a play it. I think that you should at the very least play it. And I think that it can be acquired cheaply enough that there's probably no reason to buy it. Just because, or no reason not to buy it. Wow, man, me and the English language are not getting. See, this is what happens when I take a week off and I dye my hair. Everything goes to hell in a handbasket, and I don't know what I'm doing.
Yes,
ain't it pretty? See, I'm pretty. It's everybody credited the deep dive power grid.
Oh, okay.
That's. I don't know. Yeah, boy. So what the chat is basically telling me is we need to do a deep dive on killer bunnies. That's what I understand is we need to devote
my garage.
I kind of want to talk about killer. I don't want to do an hour, but I kind of want to be like, oh, let's just fess up. It's not as bad as you know. It's kind of bad.
It's the fact that it rolls down to like a coin flip.
D12. Really, yeah.
Biggest issue.
Yeah. That you could play. Better than the 6-year-old kid who's barely paying attention and is playing games on his iPad. Mm-hmm. And because of a card flip, you lose and he wins. Yeah.
Yes.
That'd make you crazy. So, yeah.
Well, Eric just said, yeah, it's just the end game. I mean, a lot of the silliness in the game is kind of cute and fun.
It is.
Art isn't bad. It's just.
For sure. All right. So we're going to, I think it's time to wrap this sucker up. Next week, we are going to, I know we're a little shorter this week. Huge sound issues. I hope not. No, Matt, I think it's just you. Matt, we love you.
Thanks. It's Eclipse.
Hey, speaking of which, we are going to have to do a deep dive Eclipse sooner rather than later, ladies and gentlemen. This is going to have to happen.
It should have been today.
It should have been today. I know. Bill. I failed on my planning, but we need to do this because I actually just had somebody that listened to the show that sent me this really wonderful geek mail about questions about teaching Eclipse, and I shared some of my stories from G2S. I did not share you swearing at my girlfriend, Patrick.
That's right. I told that story that day.
Gotcha. All right. So next week we are going to take on the BGG rating system. Our show next week will be all about BGG ratings and whether we think they are relevant or not to gaming in 2017, because I think both Patrick and I have some opinions about how games are rated or whatever. We may have been inspired by this topic based on the pre-show when we were getting our ducks in a row here. So I'm really excited for that. But in the meanwhile, Patrick, if people want to find out more about you, where can they look?
Well, I'm on the Twitters as @OverTheHillier, and I am on What Did You Play This Week podcast as a contributor and conversationalist, interviewing people when my files are not lost in the ether.
Is that a thing that happens?
That's a thing that happened. But anyway.
That sucks.
We'll recover.
Very good. I am on Twitter @BillCoreyJr. The show is @CubistPodcast. You can go to the Cubit. Wow. Let me try that again. You can go to thecubistpodcast.com. If you want to support the show directly, there's a Patreon link on there. You can shop and buy merch, including the banana pants shirt. I would love to see people wearing banana pants shirts. I'm hoping that we see at least one or two of them at BGG. I know that what's funny is that because BGG and PAX Unplugged are on the same weekend, what I really want is Cubist stuff in both spots. So I'm going to lobby pretty hard to make that happen. But yeah, hit up the website, support the show if you feel like it. We love you. Hit that subscribe button. We love that as well. And And we are a proud member of Punchboard Media, where we all bring something to the table. Because
look at you.
You know what? I forgot on the show 2 weeks ago. Did you guys remember last week? Because I still haven't watched the show.
The ending was a disaster.
Okay. I am not watching last week's show. I'm going to enjoy my ignorance. And just ignorance is bliss. And I'm going to hope that everything was amazing. Chat room, really fast, while you guys are still here, was last week's show awesome, or do I need to go to bed and cry? That's all I need to know from you guys really fast before we sign off here. So next week we will do the BGG rating system. I believe we named the episode. What did we name it? We named it something
clever. The top 92,000 games on BGG.
Okay, because we're dorks. Yes. There you go. No, it'll be awesome. I'm really looking forward to that. And we'll probably have a slightly larger panel. I know that Brandon had his game night and Kimberly had kids stuff and other stuff came up. But we'll get there. So anyway, thank you very much for tuning in, everybody. I hope you all enjoyed it. We'll catch you all again next week. Don't forget, punchboardmedia.com. There you go. I was going to say that and we got distracted because I actually remembered the tagline and I was all excited. Go to punchboardmedia.com. You can check out all the Cuba stuff on there as well as a bunch of other content, written and video and audio. Lots of great stuff. It's a one-stop shop. So, and then the cubistpodcast.com. Thanks, everybody. We'll catch you all next week. Be good.
Thanks.
Bye. Good night.